Good evening, and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Now, this is a school, and it's not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or a religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine panoramic vision given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. This time I'd like to introduce you to school officials. The dean of the Ontario Branch School is Dr. Martin Love. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been properly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word of Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. We now know that each lord must have a name and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name. But Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce a sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now this shape and form could only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in the physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. And he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now, the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. And seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the devil, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. Okay, this evening we have prayer by Dr. Joseph Ayos. Our scripture lesson is Galatians, the 3rd chapter, and our scripture reader will be Dr. Irene Ramirez. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good evening. Let us have bowed our mind, our hearts, for a moment of prayer. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for allowing us to know your pattern, your purpose, plan, so we can for surety know that this is the place to be. Yahweh Elohim, we pray that you keep us together once more through the end of this year and next year, so that we can await for your coming of Yahshua the Messiah universally. Heavenly Father, we ask all these prayers in the name of your only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Behind you.
what it's all from you.
Good evening, class. I'll be reading Galatians, the third chapter, out of the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament. Ephesians 3. Galatians. I did? Oops, sorry. Galatians, the third chapter. O foolish Galatian, who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Yahshua, the Messiah, has been evidently set forth as the crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Have ye suffered so many things in vain? If it be yet in vain, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the working of the law or by the hearing of faith? Even as Abraham believed Yahweh, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that Yahweh would justify the heathens through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, in these shall all nations be blessed. For then they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of Yahweh. It is evident, for that just shall live by faith. Now the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth these things shall live by them. The Messiah has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the nations through Yahshua Messiah, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. Though it be but a man's covenant, yet it be confirmed no man disannulleth or add to hereto. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not to seeds, plural, but to thy seed, singular, which is his Messiah. And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before Yahweh in his Messiah, the law which came 430 years after, cannot disannul, that it should make the promise of none effect. For if the inheritance be by the law, it is no more by promise, but Yahweh gave it to Abraham by promise. Wherefore, then serveth the law. It was added because of transgression, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of the mediator. Now the mediator is not a mediator of one, but Yahweh is one. The law, then, against the promises of Yahweh, by no means. If there had been a law given which could have given life, barely righteousness should have been by the law. But the scriptures have concluded, all under sin, that the promise by faith of Yahshua the Messiah might be given to them that believe. But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster, to bring us unto the Messiah, that we might be justified by faith. But after the faith is come, we are no longer under a schoolmaster. For ye are all children of Yahweh by faith in Yahshua Messiah. For as many of you as have been immersed in the Messiah have put on the Messiah. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all in Yahshua Messiah. And if ye be in the Messiah's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. I have read Galatians, the third chapter. Let's all say hallelujah.
Alrighty, thank you for that, and good evening once again, and everybody out there in different branch schools throughout the world, and for our sisters out there in Ensenada, Helen and Karina. Okay, tonight is Tuesday night, our workshop night. Without further ado, our next speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
I know you missed that, didn't you?
Good evening. It's good to be here and good to see y'all here to learn more of this great and awesome, stupendous, colossal panoramic vision revelation given to us by Yahweh our Elohim. And as it was stated, this is workshop night. Workshop, we like to get into the nuts and bolts of things. You know, take it down to its component parts and see how it works. And then put it back together the way we found it and run with it. I had a couple of different things in my mind, but I'll take any comments, questions, or statements aforehand. What's going on there? Is that working? All right.
Yeah, if you can briefly go over Joshua and Yahshua. We understand that the death of Yahshua was at 110, and we understand of Yahshua having been baptized into the ministry at 30, 40 days in the wilderness, and he reigned on earth for 40 days after his ascension. Can you go into how to find the time frame of that 10 years?
Oh, after.
After.
After, you know, because it's 110, and right. Then 10 more would bring you to 120. 100,
you know, 10 more years for Joshua, then 10 more days that he, days
right.
That Yahshua
okay.
came and
got
that
it.
Point.
Got it.
Can you go
all
over
right.
that a little bit?
All right. I'll try to do as simple as I can. I'll go back the old fashioned way. 30, 40, 40. Okay, that's what we used to do, because we didn't have a blackboard back then. But that's how we remember, and by reading the scriptures, okay. Joshua was 30 years down here in Egypt. He was with the Israelites 40 years in the wilderness, and then 40 years in the conquest of Canaan land. Then he died at 110. His question is, how do we get to 120, the 10 after that? Okay, here's how you do that. Leviticus 25, I think it's around 5, but or 8, somewhere around there. I think it's Leviticus, the 25th chapter. 25 and, 8. 25 and well, if I get there, I'll see it and I'll know it for sure.
Number 7?
Yeah, number 8. 25 and 8. Yeah,
Leviticus 25 and 8.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt number 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee,
mm-hmm.
7 times 7 years. And the space of the 7th Sabbath of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Then thou shalt curse the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month.
Mm-hmm.
In the Day of Atonement shall ye make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. And ye shall hallow the 50th year, and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof.
Mm-hmm.
It shall be a jubilee unto you, and ye shall return every man unto his possession, and ye shall return every man unto his family. A jubilee shall that 50th year be unto you. Ye shall not sow, neither reap that which groweth of itself in it, nor gather the grapes in it of thy vine undressed. For it is the jubilee, it shall be holy unto you. Ye shall eat the increase thereof out of the field. In the year of this jubilee, ye shall return every man unto his possession.
Okay, hold it right there. Jump down to verse 24.
24. And in all the land of your possession, ye shall grant a redemption for the land.
Okay, here's the key to the question that Marlon asked. Okay, and in the land of your possession, ye shall grant a redemption for the land. In other words, they could not celebrate Jubilee until they get to Canaan's land. See, this was said to them while they were out here in the wilderness. They couldn't celebrate it because they hadn't got the land yet.
Right. Okay.
You get it? So once they got the land, remember, okay, go back. Joshua, son of Nun, 30, mm-hmm. 40, 40. In other words, after they crossed the River Jordan, Moses died at 120, right? He died here where we got Mount Nebo, this side of the Jordan. Okay, he died on this side of the Jordan, 120. Joshua took over. When he took over, that they crossed the River Jordan, that began the conquest of Canaan land for 40 years. That also began the time of the occupation in the land. So when Joshua died at 110, he had been 40 years for the conquest of Canaan's land, but also it was 40 years that they had been in the land. So then 10 years later, it would be 50, or the Jubilee. Get it? That's how you show the 10 principle up here, because that's fulfilled by Yahshua the Messiah. See, when his resurrection here, he tarried on earth for 40, let's read that. Acts 1 and 2. But do you get how you show that? Because you have to read the Jubilee, 30, 40, 40. Then 10 years after his death was their first Jubilee.
Right.
Because they would be 50 years okay. in the land.
Right.
They couldn't celebrate until they got to the land.
Right.
This law, when it was given to them, they were still here. But they hadn't got the land. They still wandering. Well, not wandering, but they're following this cloud, going hither, you know, to and fro, hither and thither. Yeah, I put it like that. But once they got here to their land, see, that began the occupation of the land. And that began then the law about the Jubilee, okay, after 50 years. Right, see, because it would start 10 years after the death of Joshua,
right.
after his 40 years.
Mm-hmm. That gives it, okay.
It would start at the end of 10 years after his death. Because, see, Joshua conquered the land for 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
Then at his death, 10 years later, would be the 50. And that would be their first Jubilee,
right.
10 years after his death. That would be, then added on to that, that would be 120.
Okay.
Just like here, read.
Acts 2 and 1.
No, 1 and 1 and, 1
oh,
and 2.
1 and 2. Until the day in which he was taken up. After that, he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen,
mm-hmm.
to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom
okay.
of Yahweh.
All right, see, the 40 days he tarried after his resurrection. The 40 days is correlated to Joshua's 40 years up here in the conquest of Canaan's land. Then after he ascended, after he ascended, see, that when he ascended, that was at the end of 40 days. Then 10 days later, you have Pentecost.
Mm-hmm. Right.
See?
Where's the 10 days later, though? I know it was a journey they took back to.
This is how you know. Go back to Leviticus. See, this is why I stress so much about the calendar. And these dates, go back to Leviticus 23 and 15.
Leviticus 23:15.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall count unto you from the morrow after the Sabbath, from the day that ye brought the sheaf of the wave offering, 7 Sabbaths shall be complete. Even until the morrow after the 7th Sabbath shall ye number 50 days.
See, 50 days. See, what? 50 days from what? 50 days from the feast of first. See, look, these feast days, we tell you about them. And Yahshua's got to fulfill them.
Right.
He's the Passover. So he's got to be on the cross, Abib the 14th. All right? His is in the burial, Abib the 15th, Feast of Unleavened Bread. No yeast in it. He's buried. Abib the 16th, Feast of First Fruits.
Mm-hmm.
He's resurrecting. Okay? 50 days later, see, you got the Feast of Weeks. Pentecost, which means 50. This is just a Greek word.
Mm-hmm.
This is a Greek version or a Greek word signifying what she just read. 7 times 7 Sabbaths plus 1, 50. Pentecost. Pente means 50 in Greek. Because it's 50 days from Yahshua's resurrection, of which he tarried on earth 40 days. 40 minus from 50 is how many?
10.
That tells, then that's how you show up. The day of Pentecost was 10 days. You see that? You got to use the law and the prophets.
10 days.
You got to go back into the law. Because he's fulfilling. He's performing jot and tittle, everything in there.
Yeah.
See? This is why I try to tell people, you know, about, especially like when we was going through the chronology, to read the scriptures. And once you understand the scriptures, then you can be able to kind of put things together. Because what he's doing here is a fulfillment of the feast days we just read. Of one of them, we just read one. But I'm saying it's the same calendar days. You say, well, how do you know this was 10 days? Well, I'm reading it. It's in the law because it's 50. It's the Feast of Weeks. This is June 6th. 50 days after his resurrection, which is the go back, 23 and 9, Leviticus 23 and 9.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, When ye be come into the land which I give unto you, and shall reap the harvest thereof, then ye shall bring a sheaf of the first fruit of your harvest unto the priest. And he shall wave the sheaf before Yahweh to be accepted for you. On the morrow after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. And ye shall offer that day when ye wave the sheaf an he lamb without blemish of the first year for a burnt offering unto Yahweh.
Okay, see, now that's Abib the 16th. That's the Feast of right. First Fruits.
Okay.
Abib the 16th. See? And so that's how you know. Because it's 50, he's fulfilling that by resurrecting on that day. And then when she read earlier about the Feast of Weeks, seven Sabbaths plus one equal 50, that brings you to here. See? Well, his question was about the 10 days. He was asking, how can you show the 10 days back here with Joshua? Because, see, people could see 40, let's see, 30, 40, 40. That's 110. Joshua lived 110 years. Okay? And then the 10 days is added on to that to bring it up to 120.
Right.
Huh? The 10 years. Is that to 120? Because Joshua is fulfilling that.
Mm-hmm.
See? Because he's added on 10 days from his... From his ascension to the day of Pentecost, 120.
That's where you get the
10. See, right, the 10. See, 100. He's fulfilling, so he's like swooping, and he's combining a lot of things. Because with the 110, he's fulfilling not only Joshua, but he's fulfilling Joseph down here,
mm-hmm.
who was 110. Who was 110. But then at 120, when he gets up there, now he's bringing in Moses and Noah and
right.
and the dynasties, the first three kings, Saul, David, and Solomon, 40 years apiece, 120 altogether. The United Monarchy, that's what I was trying to think of. So you see that now. You're just using the scriptures to show both with Joshua and with Yahshua, okay?
There's a period of time when he had the 7-day journey back to Jerusalem.
I like that, and that I'll stick with that. I got to work with that. There was a period of time after the ascension, they took a journey back 7 days. Can you use that as well, or
is
that a long way
this
around
is what,
the,
this
the
is,
bar?
Well, they, according to the scriptures, they took a Sabbath day's journey.
Yeah.
That's not 7 days. A Sabbath
that's,
day.
That's 7 days. That's just 7 days. It's not the 10.
No. I don't understand what you mean now. Because are you talking about that scripture in Acts when they said they took a Sabbath day?
Yes.
That's something different.
Okay.
See, a Sabbath day's journey is the journey. See, on the Sabbath day, you couldn't work. And walking was, if you walked too far or too much, that was considered a work. Mm-hmm. So a Sabbath day's journey was like, let's see. Let's read it. I think it's in the first chapter of Acts, I think. One and 12. Okay. Start with seven. Six. Start with six. What the heck?
Acts 1:6. When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Rabbi, wouldst thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day journey.
All right, it says a Sabbath day's journey. That's that has an apostrophe S there, right?
Yeah.
Yes, that shows possession. That means for that particular day, not 7 days, but that particular day. In other words, it was a Sabbath day journey. Now, I have a Scofield reference Bible, and it gives me a reference here for this, and it's weights and measures. And I could read this. This is a reference in my Scofield. The Sabbath day's journey is mentioned only once in the Bible, Acts 1 and 12. It was evidently the distance between Jerusalem and the Mount of Olives.
Okay.
But from what point in Jerusalem to what area of Olivet? According to limits set by the ancient rabbis, a Sabbath day's journey was 2,000 cubits or 5 furlongs. This measure may have been determined by the distance that the children of Israel were required to allow between themselves and the Ark of the Covenant at the passage of the Jordan River, Joshua 3 and 4. For the rabbis may have assumed that the same limit prevailed between the tents of the people and the tabernacle, a distance that the Israelites would need to walk in order to worship. All right. So that's pretty much what. In other words, see, they could they were already up here on the Mount Olive. They had to walk out there, all right, because they followed Yahshua out there, all right, which was a Sabbath day's journey from Jerusalem. It says 5 furlongs, 2,000 cubits, all right, and then after Yahshua's ascension, then they had to walk back from Mount Olivet back to Jerusalem. A Sabbath day's journey, which is what the rabbis consider. You know, in other words, if you walk too much, that could be considered a violation.
Mm-hmm. Doing the work.
See, you're doing the work. I said, why you walk? I mean, they understand you got to walk a certain amount, you know, to do something. But if you're walking way this, what are you doing all this walking for? You know, what's up with that? See, that even that, boy, everything was regulated.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. All right.
Thank you. Can you ask a question?
September went by so quick. You forgot to mention the new.
I kind of went through that like a month before that because he pressed on it, you know.
Yeah, but the thing is that my question was. Why did they celebrate it on the 18th this year, September 18, 2020, instead of June 6th?
Okay. Let me try to explain that. In fact, it's in the textbook, actually. It's in the textbook. Because I get that from people, because they're all, you know, they're celebrating it on the wrong date and all like that. You know, no, they're not. Because to us it's September 18th, but to them it's October, because they're on a lunar calendar. Now, here's the thing that really probably trips people out. Well, no, what I'm saying is simply this, and I'm going to show this. It's in Volume 1. It deals with the calendar. The Israelites, well, I'll get to it when I show you the calendar. Aha. Come over here. It's volume 1, page 103. Now, if you look, this is the Jewish calendar. If you look here, it says sacred and it says civil. And you see you got one column of numbers, and then in the civil, you have another column of numbers. See, because what happened, now we know in the sacred, we know that the first month is Abib, according to the sacred year. But over here in the civil, see, we got to come down here, one, which is Tishri or Ethanah, which is similar to our month of October.
Right.
And the reason why that came about is because when the Israelites were taken into the Babylonian exile, when they were taken by the Babylonians, they adopted parts of their calendar. They adopted mechanisms in their calendar. One of them was starting the year in the fall as opposed to starting it in the spring, as Yahweh told them. Dr. Kinley recognizes that. That's why he said it, put it in there like that. Use it. It's just that according to their calendar, see, to us, we're on the Gregorian calendar, which is a solar calendar. And to us, it's September 18th, to us. But to them, it's October the 1st on the lunar calendar. See, that's why we tell you. Wait a minute. Since we're back here. Let's see. Read. Volume 1, but page 98. Volume 1, page 98, in the middle. The comparison of the sacred and civil calendar.
The comparison of the sacred and civil calendar. The Jewish year being strictly lunar and the day of the new moon common to the preceding and succeeding month. The correspondence with our month vary in different years according to the intercalations. Generally speaking, the months on the following page to the Jewish months are to be taken with 10 days or less of the preceding month. But sometimes the overrunning is the other way. For example, according to the present calendar of the Jews, the first of Nisan fell on March 21st in 1882, but on April 8th in 1883.
You see how that changes? Because of the difference between the solar and lunar calendar. Continue reading.
Note, the Jewish year contains 354 days or 12 lunations of the moon.
See, 354 as opposed to 365 and a quarter, which is the solar calendar, which is the Gregorian calendar that we use. Okay, but read.
But in a cycle of 19 years, an intercalary month, Vidar, is seven times introduced to render the average length of the year nearly correct.
Now, that's their version of a leap year. And that happened 2 years ago, the year before last. It was a leap year. They had to add an extra month to make it come back around, come back into sync. Just like we have to do every 4 years in our calendar, 365 and a quarter days, every 4 years we have to insert an extra day to make it come back in sync. Go ahead.
Hence, this accounts for a difference of 243 years between the civil AM year of the world and the sacred year, or 5973 AM minus 5730 AM sacred year as of 1969.
Okay, now that was more than 50 years ago, okay? So we have to take, so when we want to do it today, we have to take into account of that. Now go back to, let's see. We're still in the first volume, page 93, read the 4 years error.
The chronological errors of 4 years. Now we can see that from 4004 BY to 1969 AD, we have a total chronological period of time, 5973 AM. Or the year of the world, to calculate all prophetic intervals or periods and the fulfillment of all events to date, including the 4 years error of chronological calculations made by Dionysius Exiguus in the 6th century AD. That is to say, he made the mistake of 4 years, which means that Yahshua the Messiah was 4 years old before the date of AD 1 actually began. BY means before the birth of Yahshua the Messiah, not before the birth of Elohim, because Elohim was in the bosom of the Father in the beginning.
All right. Now, the four-year error. You have to put that into perspective. So that's why when we talk about this, okay, we just read the other. We're on the Gregorian calendar, a solar calendar, 365 and a quarter days for a year. And the lunar year, we read that, 354 days. All right, so that's 11 and a quarter days lag. That accumulated over thousands of years turns out to be 243 years difference.
Right.
Not to mention a four-year error on top of that. So how is that reconciled? Well, according to the Jews, they will take, because they're still on the lunar calendar, which is AM, Anno Mundi. Mm-hmm. All right. Their year is 57, 81 AM, Anno Mundi, year of the world. We read that in the textbook, because mm-hmm. that's what Anno Mundi means. And we read that there was a 200, now this is the lunar calendar. And we read that there's a 243-year difference between the lunar calendar and our calendar. Mm-hmm. So we gotta add this on here. All right? And that brings us to 6,024 years. But we still got a four-year error to reckon out, because there's no four-year error in the lunar calendar. So we have to factor that out. And when we factor that out, now we come to 6,020 years from when Adam was cast out of the garden. Now, if we know that, come over here. Look here. Here's the antediluvian age. 1,656 years. From the time Adam was cast out of the garden to the flood. 1,656 years. From the time of the flood to Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection, and ascension that we just went through, it's 2,377 years. When you add these two together, you're going to come up with 4,033 years. Because we know that it's 4,000 years from Adam to Yahshua. And Yahshua's 33 years is counted in the post-diluvian age. Under the dispensation of the law. Y'all with me so far? So we got, now if this is 6,000 and we got 4,000, well then, how many years have we been since the day of Pentecost? Just simply subtract.
Okay.
7, 8, 9, 1. 1,987 years from the day of Pentecost up to now. Mm-hmm. Get it? Once you get a baseline on certain things, all other things will come into play, but you got to get the baseline. In other words, you got to read the scriptures. That's the only thing. And this is all how often have I told you this? Read, research, rehearse. These are divine instructions that anybody can do. Now, I always tell you this too. The fourth R is revelation. Mm-hmm. But that's only going to come if you do the first three. Because then when the revelation comes, you'll really understand. You say, okay. Well, I see now the logic of what Yahweh's doing. But you have to, Dr. Kinley lays it out. That's why I try to explain it. You know, I mean, a lot of times people think that what we do in workshop is intellectualizing the gospel, and we're not. We're just going through what Dr. Kinley laid out. I didn't come up with something, you know, I went right to the book. And this is in volume one, and a lot of people still don't understand this. And this is supposed to be basic. But that's what was taught to me. And like I said, we got a luxury of a board. We had to use we had to use the charts. But I'm glad, because it made us think.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't have handheld calculators like y'all do now and all that, or go to the internet. We had to walk down to the library. You know? And yet, with all this tools that, you know, at your disposal, I tell you, man, and some people will probably get pissed off at me for saying it, but the quality of students in IDMR has just gone down.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to tell you that. It's just not even.
You're not the first to say.
Not even close. You know, to what it used to be. I'm talking about as far as research and stuff like that. I mean, the things we go. I don't know. I must sound like a relic to a lot of people in a lot of cases when I go through stuff like this. You know, like what they say in Star Wars. Where'd you dig up that old fossil? You know, really. You know, but I just try to show that which was shown to me, and that if you take the time and go through this, you'll see it. You can't help but see it. A fool can't err in it. If you take the time and go through the, you know, and the research for this. So I mean, hey. Yes, sir. Well, see, let's stop and think. Because, see, 2000, let's see. Okay, look, we're at 60-20 right now. All right, we're 60-20. So to make it to 2000 would be, 13 years. Mm-hmm. That would bring us to 2000. So we're 60-20, so 13 years from this date would be 6,033.
Right.
That would be 2,000 years of this age. Now, whether we're going to make it to 2,000, I don't know. I don't know. I put it like this. I wouldn't worry about this date. I would worry about the end of this date, the end or whatever. I would worry about whether you translate it now. In the kingdom, because if you translate it now, then you ain't got nothing to worry about what date it is. Because if you translate it now, see, you're translated forever, no matter what. Even, you know, if you happen to be in the flesh when this whole thing comes about, fine. But if you happen to take off the flesh before this whole thing, as long as you translate it, then you will continue on eternally in Yahshua. Well, you're already in everybody's in the book of life. The thing you don't want is to be blotted out of the book.
Yeah.
Everybody who's ever lived has been in the book of life. Adolf Hitler was in the book of life, but he just got blotted out. That's all. That's what you don't want your name blotted out of that.
Yeah.
See? Okay. I don't know why I grabbed this. The Apostolic Fathers, the modern era, because we went through history, right? Y'all remember history? History is threefold, right? What's the threefold stage of history? Anybody remember? Ancient, medieval, and modern, all right? Those are three stages of history. Ancient, medieval, or Middle Ages. Medieval is probably a better term. And then the modern. How long was the ancient times? How long were they? How long? For the years. Y'all remember that? From the time of Adam, which Usher would say 4004, I'll just say that like that, 4004 BC, until the fall of the Roman Empire, pagan Rome here. In 476 A.D., that is considered the ancient time of history, the ancient period, all right? Mm-hmm. After 476, we go into the medieval era. You know, was that movie, what was that movie with John Travolta was there? He said, we have to get medieval on you. Pulp Fiction, yeah, I saw that in school. They played it in school. I had to write an essay on it. I got an A. But that began the medieval period. And that lasted from 476, or we'll say 500 A.D., which included the papacy, till about 1500 A.D. That would be the beginning of the Renaissance, which means rebirth, and the Reformation with Martin Luther, you know, and the Protestant revolt, so to speak. And from 1500 on to the present would be considered the modern era. We got England over here. That's representative of that, because it was the what kicked off the modern era was the global trade and the Industrial Revolution. Not only just in, you know, mechanics, but also in ideas and things like that. And England was at the forefront of it, okay, of the modern era. So we've only been in the modern era for like 600 years, since 1500. The, all of that, you know, the global, the, you know, slavery existed for all the, goes all the way back. The difference was that when the 1500s came and the so-called discoveries of the New World, the Americas, so to speak, and people began to, well, you know, I mean, gosh. I can't do a whole history lesson here, because see, I mean, because then you know you'd have to go back to Marco Polo and his voyage to China, because that's what got Europeans interested in the Far East, because of the goods they could get from there. Even the Roman Empire, people don't believe it, but the Roman Empire in its days of the Caesars had trade with Imperial China, what they called the Silk Road. Okay, and so they had products and things that they didn't have in Europe, like certain spices. I mean, to eat certain foods in Europe, it was pretty bland, because all you had was salt, you know, and you didn't have any other spices. So, I mean, that we take for granted, like pepper, for example, there was no black pepper in Europe during the medieval times. Or certain foods that we know about now that we don't even think about, like potatoes. Potatoes didn't exist in medieval times, or corn. Corn is a New World product that was made by the native peoples. So, I mean, you know, they didn't have, I mean, so the diet was totally different. Things we think about, like chocolate, for example. There was no chocolate in medieval times. That's a New World product. Or squash. Or things, you know. And so, and then same way with different continents, like in Asia, things like spaghetti. When we think of spaghetti, we think of it as an Italian thing, but spaghetti actually comes from China. Noodles and stuff like that. I mean, and trade, you know, it's not the beginning. Trade has always been between countries, but now in the modern era, it's taken on more of a global aspect, because now it's traversing different lands across great distances and for goods and things. And because of trade, and people began to have different ideas about trade, that spurred on. It really spurred on the modern era as we know it, because with trade and people started begin thinking about things, inventions began to happen. People began to look at different products, you know, like, okay, like tobacco, for example. They didn't have nothing in Europe like tobacco, but then when the Europeans found out about tobacco, they were like, man, this is a pretty neat thing here. and cotton. You know, growing cotton, you know, then somebody invented a cotton gin, you know, that was able to take the seeds apart. And then you had the Industrial Revolution, where you can make more cotton products, because cotton, you know, makes very nice products, soft and stuff. I mean, it used to be cotton was for the rich people. But now it's, you know, mass production now made it available for everybody else. And then on top of that, people started having different ideas. I said, well, you know, if we let people have a little more money, then they can spend more money. We can get a little more richer by getting more people in the game. And that's how this global economy comes about. And you say, well, let's just spread it around so that the more people, you know, people begin to think. I said, well, shoot, you know, it used to be like, there's an old saying. It says, like a Rolls Royce. Used to be like Rolls Royce, you know, yeah, it's an expensive car, but only the rich people can buy it. But Henry Ford got richer than Rolls Royce because he built a car that everybody could buy.
Right.
You get it?
Uh-huh.
And that's how people began to start thinking, because it used to be in medieval times, people just did things for the rich because only the rich could afford it. Whereas the majority of people were serfs, they were slaves themselves. They were owned by the land, by the whoever owned the land. You know, you belong to me. You couldn't get put, you had to ask your landowner, your master, who to marry, when to marry, you know, and they could say yes, no, or whatever, because they owned it. You know, you got pigs or something, that livestock wasn't yours, that belonged to the landowner. You belong to the landowner. He could sell your ass if he wanted to.
Right.
People don't think about that, but that was in medieval times. And so then people began to start thinking about, you know, other ideas, you know, stuff like that. And as more people began to migrate and begin to find out about other different distant lands and stuff, then people started, you know, started getting more innovative. They started getting to thinking about trade, more products, more different goods. And as that began to grow, that just changed everything. Like I said, on the global scale, you know, yeah, like, you know, with the slaves, you know, that was the big deal. Because they would take slaves from Africa, you know, from there and port them to America, trade it for tobacco and gold, I mean, cotton and stuff, and then take that stuff to England, right, to the manufacturer, and then they would make, you know, cotton clothes out of it. You know, they make cigars and cigarettes from the tobacco, and, you know, and rum and sugar. That was old. You can't forget sugar. Sugar was a big-time moneymaker in the, you know, in those days. And, you know, they would make products from that, and then they'd, like, rum, and then they would get these products and they'd sell them to the people in Africa. They would trade it for that, and they would say, okay, wait here, we'll go into the interior, we'll get some more people, and then we'll trade for that. And that was, like, the Atlantic trade. And it was very, very lucrative. England became an empire. England became an empire because of the slave trade, all right? See, that was it because of trade. See, and that spurred on a lot of other things, like a navy, because to protect the ship, because people, you know, like pirates and stuff, then you got to have a navy to protect the trade routes and things like that, you know, and yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. See the modern world. This is really, if you really understood this chart, this is really an explanation of history, because this is ancient history. All this is ancient history till we get to pagan Rome, and then we get to papal Rome. That's medieval history, and then from there we get to modern history. Because remember, they broke away.
Right.
It's okay. Got wife and husband. They divorced themselves from that, and this is representation of the modern era. And America is a breakaway colony from England, and America is a big representation of that modern era. See, Western civilization, and people have copied. You know, other countries say, "Oh, okay, well, let's try this." And not only have they copied, but they've also succeeded. We're to the point that, hey, you know, we're doing better than these guys. See, but it's all part of Western civilization. What we call the Western tradition, that you can go back, trace this back, papal Rome, pagan Rome, back to the Greeks, back to the Medes and Persians, back to Nebuchadnezzar, back to the Tower of Babel, back to Enoch, back to this guy right here who was kicked out of heaven, and he's, you know, deceiving Eve. See, all of this starts from there. Human government. See. Combined that with a carnal mind, a physical body, a satanic spirit, and a carnal mind wrapped up into one. See.
Yeah, so that's the convention of money and all that, and snowballed into
people. Well, see, this is what, in Revelations, it talks about that. It talks about traffic and trade. That's why I try to get into all the, when you talk about human government, it entails all of that. You know, government, traffic, trade, religion. Because ideas, you know, I mean, people traffic in ideas too. You know, religion, all of that. That's why we got that one chart of, you know, about all the different, these different kingdoms. See, these different kingdoms and these corporations that run them, those are the giants of the world that really run the world. You know, people talk about, oh, this is a conspiracy. No, man, a corporation is not a conspiracy. This is pretty much out front and forward, you know. They don't mind letting you know, you know, or pushing their weight around, you know, something like that. They don't mind that. They've been doing it, you know, in government and all. And so, I mean, the whole idea is that, look, Dr. Kinley said it best. He says that he talked about a carnal mind, and we know that a carnal mind is fleshly, but here's the one thing he said about it. He said, look, said that as far as the human mind is concerned, it is subject to change, either for better or for worse. So if that be the case just for any individual, as far as your mind, and human government is based on the human mind, then like the human mind, you know, it is subject to change, either for better or for worse. Okay, and that's always going to be that way. See, and it's never going to be any government that's going to be perfect or like put it like this, to be like Yahshua and Messiah. Now look, here's Solomon up here. If any government was going to be anything close to the king, it would be his government. And what happened to him? He married 700 women and had 300 concubines and began to listen to his wives and began to build temples to their gods. See, he changed for better or for worse, because that's the way. And this was, I mean, and he was a type. He was a type of the King of Kings, okay? He was a type of the King of Kings because he had all them wives, and he had all them Gentile in-laws as kings, and they had to come in to visit Jerusalem every year to give alms. And there was a court for the Jews, and a court for the priests, and a court for the Gentiles. And the Gentiles be out there, he'd come out to the veranda, and he'd greet them, and he's standing up there, and they're out there in the court, his Gentile in-laws, the kings and their wives, but here he is standing up here, king over kings. He was a type, but because he was under the law, under the dispensation of the law, he couldn't be perfect. He was a type to show forth, you know, the type of Yahshua, but none of them were perfect. None of them, even Abraham, you know. Father of faith, you know, and all, but he wasn't perfect. None of them were. They all fell. They not until he come along. See, not until he come along. He was the only one that could perform that which was given, because he was the one who gave it. That's the only reason why he could perform it. He was the one who gave it. See, you know, I mean, we say it ourselves. You know, when a job needs to be done, well, it's best to do it yourself. Well, that's what he did. See, they couldn't do it. They couldn't perform this law, so he came and did it himself and moved it out the way for them. Okay?
Can you touch back on your, I don't know how to connect, Cyrus, Darius,
and Artaxerxes. Right. Okay, let me see here. Well, they were not the only kings of Media and Persia, but they're the only ones that are mentioned in the Bible. Okay. To get Cyrus right quick, you can just read Ezra 1 and 1. See, let me...
I'm familiar with
it. Tell you what, before you read that...
Thank you.
BBY, when the Israelites left Egypt, or you can even say when the tabernacle was dedicated. And we always tell you about the 490-year cycles, okay? All right? So 490 years from this date would give you the 1001 BBY. This is when the temple was dedicated, okay? Now, if you remember, there's 3 years in the dedication. So, 3 years before that, would be 1004 BBY when the temple was finished, but not dedicated. This is in the textbook. You can, just to show you that it is in there. Go to volume 4. And there's a reason why I'm doing this, because I'm getting to his question, but I wanted to throw this in here since he asked it. What's in here?
Volume 1?
Volume 4. Page 46, volume 4. No, maybe not that. Actually, 42, page 42, go there.
Following the chronology compares.
Need your help. Okay, this is what I'm talking about. Page 42, this is the chronology comparing Solomon's temple to Yahshua Messiah. And see, we got, why don't you just read that?
1491 BY, departure of Israel from Egypt. We sometimes use 1490
BY. See, I've always said that. See, you could use one or the other. It just depends on what correlation you're using. In this case, we're using 1491. Continue.
Minus 476 years, time from the departure to the beginning of Solomon's reign, 1015 BY. Solomon began to reign. Minus 4 years, Solomon laid the foundation of the temple in the fourth year after he began to reign. 1011 BY, 480th year after the departure of Israel from Egypt, when the foundation of Solomon's temple was laid. Minus 7 years, 7 years, 6 months is the length of time Solomon's temple was in construction. 1004 BY, 487th year, Solomon's temple finished, but dedication was deferred.
See, I just told you, 1004. Well, I got it up on the board, okay? Go ahead and finish reading.
Minus 3 years.
Uh-huh.
Number of years taken to move furniture of tabernacle and new furniture into the temple and keep the feast. See also Yahshua after his baptism by John choosing his disciples and the 3 years of his ministry. 1001 BY, which is really 1000 BY because of the half years. 490 years after the Israelites departed from Egypt is the time of the dedication and also the opening of the fourth millennium. Minus 30 years, number of years Solomon's temple stood without molestation after the dedication. 931 BY, King Shishak from Egypt invaded Jerusalem and spoiled the temple. This makes a total time of 33 years that the temple stood after it was finished before being molested, whereby the temple was a figure of the total lifespan, 33 years of Yahshua the Messiah, AD 33.
Okay. See, threw that in there about Shishak, because the temple stood unmolested for 33 years after it was finished. Okay, but now, here's the part I want. 1004, it was finished. All right, now get Exodus 33 and 5, I think. Where are we at here? No, I want Exodus first. I want Exodus 33 and 5.
For Yahweh has said unto Moses, say unto the children of Israel.
I'm sorry, maybe 34, because I want maybe 34 and 5. Maybe that's what I want.
34 and 5. And Yahweh descended into the cloud, okay, and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh passed by before him and proclaimed, Yahweh, Yahweh El, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundance in goodness and truth,
mm-hmm,
keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin, and that will by no means, and sin, no means, clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children until the third and to the fourth generation.
All right. To the third and the fourth generation. We'll take the higher number. Fourth generation. Zeros can be added or subtracted. In this case, we're going to add zeros to the fourth generation. And we'll make it 400 years. Now, when you subtract that, that would make you to 604 BBY. So the question you want to ask is, well, what happened in 604 BBY? 2 Kings 24 and 1.
Second Kings 24 and 1.
Uh-huh.
In his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up,
mm-hmm.
and Jehoiakim became his servant 3 years.
Uh-huh. Now he came up. See, this is the year Nebuchadnezzar came up, 604 BBY, 400 years after the completion of Solomon's temple. And he conquered Judah. And they became his servant for 3 years. All right, read.
Then he turned and rebelled against them.
Now, when that happened, that would make it 601
mm-hmm.
BBY. The times, the beginning of the times of the Gentiles. This was the year that Nebuchadnezzar began to exporting people from Judah. Daniel was among them. Okay? Now, I just threw that in there as a side. But here's the point I wanted to get over here, because he asked about Cyrus. And I'm getting to that, but I'm throwing some stuff up here to lead up to this. Get Jeremiah 25 and 11.
Jeremiah 25:11.
Uh-huh.
And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years.
Shall serve them 70 years. When did that 70 years begin? It began in 604 BBY, because we just read it. And then he was a servant for 3 years, and then in 601 he rebelled, but then Nebuchadnezzar slapped him down for that. All right, but 604 was when Nebuchadnezzar began to reign, and he said it would reign for 70 years. Now, let's read Ezra 1 and 1 with Cyrus, because see, if that be the case, and we just read it according to prophecy, it would be 70 years. Read.
What's the name of the book?
Ezra.
Ezra.
Ezra. Ezra. E-Z-R-A.
Now, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia,
uh-huh.
that the word of Yahweh by the mouth of the Jeremiah might be fulfilled.
Now, did we just read something about Jeremiah? Now, here we go. We're reading the fulfillment of that. Read.
Yahweh stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia,
mm-hmm.
that he made a proclamation throughout all his kingdom, and put in also in writing, saying, Thus say Cyrus, king of Persia, Yahweh, the Elohim of heavens, hath given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he hath charged me to build him an house, Jerusalem, which is in Judah,
mm-hmm.
who is among you all his people. His Elohim be with him,
mm-hmm.
and let him go up to Jerusalem, which is in Judah, and built the house of Yahweh, the Elohim of Israel.
Okay, good enough. Now, he said by the mouth of Jeremiah, right? Is that what Cyrus said?
Yes.
Well, what did Jeremiah say? Didn't we just read it?
Mm-hmm.
What did Jeremiah say? Hello?
Jeremiah.
What did Jeremiah say? We read Jeremiah. What did Jeremiah say? He said what? They will serve the king of Babylon 70 years. So if they began serving in 604, then 70 years.
Hmm?
534 is the year Cyrus lets them. He frees them.
Okay.
Do you understand? Everybody understanding this? If Nebuchadnezzar conquered Israel in 604 and put them into captivity, and according to the word of Jeremiah, which he spoke by the Holy Spirit, mind you, that they would be in captivity for 70 years.
Right.
So when Cyrus releases them, it has to be the year 534 BBY.
Okay.
Well, I wouldn't go that far. But I'm just saying he released them from according to the 70 years that Yahweh told you, you know, through the mouth of Jeremiah. Right. So if you determine that 604 is when Nebuchadnezzar conquered Judah, 70 years from that would be 534 BBY, when they went back, talking about Zerubbabel, to build the temple. Because if you look up here, see, here we've got 510 BBY, Zerubbabel's temple dedicated. It's 490 years from the dedication of Solomon's temple, which we just read was 1,001 or 1,000 because of the half years.
Right.
So now if Zerubbabel's temple was 510 BBY in its dedication, and they went back according to the commandment of Cyrus in the year 534, oh, I can tell you quite easily that it took Zerubbabel and his friends 24 years to rebuild that temple. You understand?
Okay.
And see, and the reason why I say that, because see, it goes back to Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes. Because when they came back to build that temple, see, Judah had already been overrun by other Gentile nations. Nebuchadnezzar, he uprooted the Israelites, Judah, and took them back to Babylon. Likewise, he did that to other peoples and planted them there in Canaan's land. And so when the Hebrews came back and started rebuilding the temple, they were like, oh, what's up with these people? Okay, so now we're in the go to Ezra, the sixth chapter.
That was only Judah, right?
See, that was for Judah. And see, when they went back, the governor, read 5 and 6. Ezra 5 and 6.
The copy of the letter that
I don't know what you're reading out of my system.
Tatnai, probably it's right. Tatnai, governor on this side, the river, and Shethar Bozani.
Come on.
And his companions, that's another one.
Ephesites.
Ephesites.
See, these are people, Gentile nations that Nebuchadnezzar planted in Canaan's land. Because, see, that was a very common thing in ancient times. To break a people's spirit, you just uproot them from their land and send them somewhere else that's alien and foreign to what they're used to. And so it's the same thing happening here. But read.
Which were on this side of the river, sent unto Darius the king. They sent a letter unto him, wherein was written thus unto Darius the king of all peace. Be it known unto the king that we went into the province of Judah to the house of the great Eloa, which is built with the great stones, and the timber is laid in the walls. And this work goes fast on, and the prospereth in their hands. Then asked we those elders, and said unto them, thus, who commandeth you to build this house and to make up these walls? We asked their names also to certify thee, that we might write the names of the men that were the chief of them.
Okay, so now these people saw them, you know, saw these Jews building the temple, and they went, and they just started asking, who commanded you to build this house? Who commanded you to make up these walls? Who told you, who gave you the authority to do this? And they're like saying, I'm cutting this up because we don't have much time. And they're telling them, I said, well, look, we got a decree. Jump down to, 13th verse, Or just read, really, but read a little faster, because we're running out of time here.
And thus they return us, answer, saying, we are the servants of Elohim of heaven and earth, and built the house that was built these many years ago, which is the great king of Israel built and set up. But after that, our fathers had provoked Elohim of heaven unto wrath. He gave them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed this house and carried the people away into Babylon. But in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Babylon, the same king Cyrus made a decree to build this house of Elohim, and the vessels also of gold and silver, and the house of Elohim, which Nebuchadnezzar took out of the temple that was in Jerusalem, and brought them into the temple of Babylon, whose did Cyrus the king take out of the temple of Babylon, and they were delivered unto one, whose name was Shazar, who he had made governor, and said unto him, take these vessels, go, carry them into the temple that is in Jerusalem, and let the house of Elohim be built in his place. Then came the name of Shelzebar, and laid the foundation of the house of Elohim, which is in Jerusalem. And since that time, even unto now, hath he been in the building, and yet is not finished. Now thereto it is seven seem good to the king, let there be search made in the king's treasure house, which is there at Babylon, whether be so that a decree was made by Cyrus, the king that built this house of Elohim at Jerusalem, and let the king send his pleasure to us concerning this matter.
Okay, so now he's writing a letter to the king, because the Jews said, well, we got permission to do this from Cyrus, because he gave the order, he let us go, and he gave us the vessels that Nebuchadnezzar took from us, and that's it. So now keep reading.
Then Darius the king made a decree, and search was made in the house of the rolls, where the treasure were laid up in Babylon. And there was found at Achaemenia in the palace that is in the province of the Medes a roll, and therein was a record thus written. In the first year Cyrus the king, the same Cyrus the king, made a decree concerning the house of Elohim at Jerusalem, let the house be built, and the place where they offered sacrifices, and the lot, let the foundation thereof be strongly laid.
Okay, that's good enough, because it just goes on. But it just, all it is that Darius, who was king, because Cyrus is dead at this point, he found the record of Cyrus's decree, mm-hmm, giving these people authorization. So that's why he's mentioned in this. Okay? Now, see, go to Nehemiah.
Oh, Nehemiah. Oh my gosh.
I think it's the second chapter. Chapter 2.
And it came to pass in the month Nisan, in the 20th year, Artaxerxes the king, that wine was before him. And I took up the wine and gave it unto the king. Now I had not been before time sad in his presence. Wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad, seeing thou art not sick? This is nothing else but sorrow of heart. Then I was very sore afraid, and said unto the king, let the king live forever. Why should not my countenance be sad, when the city, the place of my father's sepulchres, lieth waste, and the gates thereof are consumed with fire? Then the king said unto me, for what dost thou make request? So I prayed to Elohim of heaven, and I said unto the king, if it be if it please the king, and if thy servant have found favor in thy sight, that thou wouldest send me unto Judah, unto the city of my father's sepulchre, that I may build it. And the king said unto me, the queen also sitting by him, for how long shall thy journey be, and when will thy return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. Moreover, I said unto the king, if it please the king, let letters be given me to the governor beyond the river, that they may convey me over till I come into Judah. And a letter unto
Asaph,
the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gate of the palace, which appertains to the house, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall enter into. And the king granted me, according to the good hand of my Elohim upon me. Then I came.
Okay, good enough. Good enough. Okay, now this is the commandment from Artaxerxes. All right. This is the commandment to Nehemiah to rebuild the wall. All right, let's come up here. We already told you about, 490 years of Solomon's temple. We told you it was 1,000 or 1,001. To Zerubbabel's temple, which was dedicated in 510. We showed you over there that it had to be built in 534 when Cyrus gave the decree, and it took them 24 years. Now, here's the thing that they don't tell you about the rebuilding of Zerubbabel, of the Zerubbabel temple. See, they had a tool in one hand and a sword in the other. Because, see, that guy who wrote the letter to the king, see, they was harassing them, really. And so they had to be on their guard. They literally had to work with a tool in one hand and a sword in another. Literally. For 24 years, okay? So now, when we come up here, the 510 BBY, so you see, okay, look, we got these cycles here. Right. 70 weeks, okay, 490 years. Here is at the end of a cycle, 510. Now, if you notice, there's a gap between 510 and 457 BBY. We have Artaxerxes here. We just read that, the commandment of Artaxerxes. Now, told you Zerubbabel's temple was dedicated in 510 BBY, which is 53 years. That's a 53-year gap between the two cycles, which would bring it to 457 BBY when Artaxerxes gives the commandment that what Sunshine just read. Mm-hmm. All right, that's the date right here. Okay, now that's now there were more than three kings of Persia. There were several of them. But these are the three kings mentioned in the Bible. That's germane to the purpose of the Bible. Cyrus was the one that let the Israelites go to rebuild Solomon's temple or to build the Zerubbabel's temple. Darius was the king on whom these guys they complained to. He searched the archives and confirmed the order that Cyrus gave.
Okay.
Artaxerxes is the one who gave the order to rebuild the wall, because Nebuchadnezzar tore down the temple and the wall around Jerusalem. They had the order to rebuild the temple, but it was unprotected. So Nehemiah just said, well, we need a wall. Okay, fine. I'll give you a commandment to rebuild the wall around Jerusalem to protect the temple. So that's why we talk about Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes. And then with Artaxerxes, when he gave the commandment, see, his commandment in 457 BBY, that's another cycle, and that brings to AD 33, which is Pentecost. So when we add AD 33, which is Pentecost, that will show you right there that it's 490 years from the commandment of Artaxerxes. Okay? See, Dr. Kinley gives you a framework to work with if you understand it. And it's really not hard to understand. The thing is, most people tend not to, it's not taught like it used to be. I just tell it to you straight. It's just not taught like the way it used to be, because he would show this, and then if you understood the then you could, then you would know what the dates are and all these. If you would know once you got the baseline, mm-hmm. then you can, and then you read the scriptures, and that will show you where the dates are at. See? Okay? We okay? How we doing?
Fine.
But all I'm saying is, read, research, rehearse. Mm-hmm. And the revelation will come. Yahweh will show. These charts, the more you engage these charts, the more they'll engage you. Because they will force you to go into the scriptures, which is the law and the prophets, so that you can see what's happening. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Kinley said, certain things he said, if you just remember, it will just help you out. Like, for example, I heard him say something like, if you understood what the Old Testament was about, you would understand what's happening in the world. Mm-hmm. Because everything that's happening in the world is simply a repeat of things that's happening in the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. So once you understand what Moses and the prophets wrote, then you'll understand what's happening now. Because it's just a repeat of that, mm-hmm. in all facets, you know, in some ways bigger and better. I mean, look, the principle remains the same. The manifestation may change, mm-hmm. but the principle will always remain the same. That's the thing you always say, and that's the thing we try to show you, what the principles are. And the same principles that are on these charts is the same principles that you use to identify the satanic spirit. Right. Perfection pointing out imperfection. It's the same thing. The thing about it is that I believe the founder wanted us to do was to, when we go through these charts, we practice identifying the principles that are on here, even with the numbers, because mm-hmm. it's all principles or precepts. See, and that you go through it, and the constant going through with these principles, hopefully, it's like what we used to say with a mule, old Missouri mule, because he's hard-headed. You just have to keep whacking that sucker. One of them whacks is going to get through. It's going to be like, bang, and the mule's going to say, aha, you know. And that's the way it is, you know, with us. We go through these, and then one of these times you're going through this, you're going to get an aha moment. You'll be like, oh, mm-hmm. okay, uh-huh, oh, all right, see, uh-huh.
So the wall, this wall is about the same wall of the Lamentation in Jerusalem.
The wall in Jerusalem is the western wall of the temple. That's what's left of the Herodian temple. See, oh gosh, since I'm talking about these temples, may as well bring him into the mix. Find me the scripture where Yahshua's in the temple, and he says, tear this temple down, and in 3 days I'll bring it up. Give me that scripture. Is it in John, I think, or Matthew? One of them. What's this? Do we have it?
No, I'm still good.
What is it? What? I can't hear you.
2 Corinthians 10:13?
No, that can't be, because that's not Yahshua. No, he said, tear down this temple, and 3 days I'll raise it up. Paul ain't saying nothing like that. You ain't going to find that in Corinthians. Do I have to go to my Bible and look at it? Come on, y'all. Don't y'all have references in y'all Bible, you know, for words and stuff? Where are you?
Matthew 24, I think. And Joshua went out and departed from the temple, and the disciples came unto him to show him the buildings of the temple. And Joshua said unto them, see that all these things.
No, that's not what it says. In 3 days, I will raise it up.
2:19.
That's what I thought. I knew it was in John.
John
2:19. That's not what I want. Because that's
John 2:19.
This is early on in the beginning of his ministry.
Joshua.
No, wait now.
Okay.
Let me read here, because I need a predicate.
Okay.
See, never do a subject unless you got a predicate going. All right, 18:2:18.
Then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign showest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things? Joshua answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up.
Now he said that. Now the reason why they asked him that, if we had read it, we would have found out that Joshua had made some cords and he whipped them. You know, the money changers out. You know, and they asked him, they said, wait a minute, by what authority? I mean, yeah, because people don't think about Joshua, but here he is. He's got some cords. He's whipping some folks out of the temple. You know. And they asked him and said, you don't make my house a house of merchandise, you know. Maybe we should read that. Let's go back and get a real predicate. Back to 13.
13?
Yeah, let's start.
And when the Passover was at hand, Joshua went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables and said unto them that sold doves, take these things hence, make not my father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal for thine house has eaten me up. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign showest thou unto us, seeing that thou doest these things? Joshua answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? But he spake of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Joshua had said.
Okay, good enough. All right. Now, he just got through whipping these folks out of the temple. And they was asking him, why, by what authority you do this? And he gave him a sign. He said, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up. But see, they thought, because they were in the temple.
Right.
They were in the temple, and they thought, oh, man, 46 years, man. You're going to raise it up in 3 days, but that's not what he said. He said, destroy this. They didn't know the difference between this and that. He just said, destroy this temple, in 3 days I'll raise it up. Now, see, and they said 46 years. What do you mean? This is in the first year of Joshua's ministry. So he's 30 years old at this time. And this is not really long after he was baptized by John the Baptist and went into the wilderness and all of that. But this is in his first year. He's 30 years old. Now, they said 46 years was it in the building. Now, Herod built this temple in 16 BBY. That's when Herod, I'm talking about Herod the Great. That's when he started building this temple, all right?
Mm-hmm.
And then Joshua was 30 years old when he's up in the temple and he's telling them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll rear it up. That's why they said 46 years was there in the building. So now how many years is Joshua in his ministry?
Three and a half years.
So when you add 3 to that, that will bring you to 49. That's the principle of 49 with Joshua.
Right.
See? But now Herod's temple, it lasted. In fact, I could tell you the exact date. Herod's temple was destroyed by Titus of Rome. August the 9th, 70 AD. August, and that's when Titus destroyed the temple, okay, in AD 70, okay? That's, you know, that, and that was, and what's left of it is what they call the Wailing Wall. It's the western wall of the temple. In other words, the western wall would be the wall that's that, you know, that where the Ark of the Covenant never sat there, but it would be the most holy place. Mm-hmm. What was in there was a rock. Now, if you can imagine, the Roman general Titus is surprised because, see, nobody was allowed into the most holy place of the temple. All right, he said, "Oh no, it's sacred." And so Titus, after he conquered the city, he was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna walk up in here. Yeah, I'm gonna see what's up in here." And he walks up in there, and there's nothing up in there. It's nothing except a rock.
Surprise!
A rock, because it was on a mountain. It was on Mount Moriah. And that rock that was in there was the same rock that Abraham offered up Isaac on. The Jews call it the foundation stone because they say that this stone was there at the beginning of all creation, so forth and so on. Okay, but yeah, you know, that was Titus. And see, and they burnt that temple down. They burnt it down. I think, didn't he make an arch? Yeah, make an arch. Titus made an arch of triumph, where they showed him taking the lampstand and stuff from the temple. When you read the scriptures, you'll find out certain things. Like, for example, let's go back and read it. Go to 2 Kings, how are we doing on time there?
10 minutes.
10 minutes? Okay. I'll try to expedite this. I think it's the 26th chapter? 25th chapter. 2 Kings 25:8, quickly.
And in the fifth month, on the seventh day of the month, which is the 19th year of the king Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came Nebuzaradan, captain of the guard, a servant of the king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem. And he burnt the house of Yahweh, and the king's house, and all the houses of Jerusalem, and every great man's house burnt he with fire. And all the army of the Chaldeans that were with the captain of the guard brake down the wall of Jerusalem round about. Now the rest of the people that were left in the city, and the fugitives that fell away to the king of Babylon, with the remnant of the multitude did Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard, carry away. But the captain of the guard left of the poor of the land to be vine dressers and husbandmen.
Okay, all right, good enough. Now he took the cream of the crop of the people away, but the poor folks, he said, "No, y'all, you just police the area, you know, just keep it clean, you know, till we get back, for us, right?" Okay, now. They burnt down the house of Yahweh, which was Solomon's temple.
They
destroyed the wall around the Jerusalem, okay? Because we went through that, so I'm just showing you that, okay? And when they burnt down Solomon's temple, they also plundered the vessels, all right? Get Daniel. We'll show you two of the vessels that they took. I want Daniel. This is the fifth chapter, maybe in the Holy Name.
Daniel 5, beginning.
You in the Holy Name?
Yes.
Read.
In the first year of Belshazzar.
No. Then it's the seventh chapter then.
Seventh.
If you're in the Holy Name.
Belshazzar, the king, made a great feast.
Come on.
To 1,000 of his princes, and drank wine before the thousands. Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines might drink therein. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of the Lord, which was at Jerusalem, and the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines drank in them. They drank wine and praised the idols of gold and of silver, of brass, of iron, of wood, and of stone. In the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins was loose, and his knees smote once one against another.
Okay, good enough. Yeah. All right, so now the lampstand. What lampstand are you talking about? The lampstand that was the same lampstand that was in this tabernacle. See, look. When this tabernacle was taken to Cana's land, eventually it sat on Mount Zion, which is in Jerusalem. It didn't get there until David conquered the city. It sat on Mount Zion for 45 years. Then when the temple was built, the golden objects were moved into the temple, i.e. the lampstand, table of showbread, the altar of incense, and the Ark of the Covenant. Now, this was in Solomon's temple when Nebuchadnezzar burnt it down. But before they burnt it down, they plundered it. Mm-hmm. And we just read they took the golden vessels. Mm-hmm. But I'm trying to clarify which golden vessels they took. The only golden vessels they took was the lampstand and the table of showbread. Okay, we just read about the lampstand and Belshazzar, he's got his feet up on the table of shewbread. What was the table of shewbread? Okay, but that's what they took. Now the question you want to ask is, what happened to the altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant? Now to find out about that, then you're going to have to go to the Book of Maccabees. Get the Jerusalem Bible over there, and find the second Maccabees, the second chapter. Quickly, it's over there. I can see it from here.
Yeah.
Well, see, it was part that in ceremony. Because,
right, okay.
I mean, because look, Mount Zion and Mount Moriah are both in the same city. You know, they're in the same city of Jerusalem. Okay? But it was a ceremony, you know, for 3 years that what it took, you know, as far as moving these things in into the temple. Okay? And 3 years for the dedication, because I think it started on the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Ingathering. Okay, it lasted 3 years. Do we have that?
604, the second book of Maccabees.
The second book of Maccabees, the second chapter. 2 and 1.
Okay. Jeremiah concealed the tabernacle.
I can't hear you.
Altar. Jeremiah concealed the tabernacle, ark, and altar. We find in the archives that the prophet Jeremiah, when he had given the deportees the order to take the fire, as we have described, mm-hmm. and given them the law, warned the deportees never to forget Yahweh's precept, nor to let their thoughts be tempted by the sight of gold and silver satis or the finery adorning them. Among other similar admonitions, he urged them not to let the law depart from their hearts. The document also describes how the prophets, warned by an oracle, gave orders for the tabernacle and the ark to go with him when he set out for the mountain when Moses had climbed to survey Yahweh's heritage. On his arrival, Jeremiah found a cave dwelling into which he brought the tabernacle, the ark, and the altar of incense, afterwards blocking up the entrance. Some of his companions came up to mark out the way, but were unable to find it. When Jeremiah learned this, he reproached them. The place is to remain unknown, he said, until Yahweh gather his people together again and show them his mercy. Then Yahweh...
Good enough. Thank you. All right. Now, she just read that Jeremiah took the Ark of the Covenant and the altar of incense to the same spot where Moses was buried, Mount Nebo. In other words, it was on this side of the river, so they had to come to the other side of the river to Mount Nebo. See, and that fits just well what we read with Daniel, because in Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar, he took the lampstand and the table of shewbread. But Jeremiah took the altar of incense and the Ark of the Covenant and hid it in Mount Nebo, which is the same place where Moses was buried at. Now, if you understand that, then you'll understand this. Jude, the book of Jude. See, because people, would trip on this. At least I used to when I read it, because I didn't understand what would be the purpose of it until I went through these scriptures. Jude 9.
Yet Michael the archangel, which contending with the adversary concerning the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, Yahweh rebuke thee.
Okay, now I always wonder, what would Satan want with the body of Moses? I never understood that. But he's not asking for the body. He's a deceiver. He's a liar. He's like, Michael, what's up, man? Well, yeah, hey, Michael, it's just on the by, man. But where did y'all bury Moses at?
Yeah.
Like he really want to know where Moses, but he reads the scriptures too. We show he reads the scriptures as well as everything else. And he read that the Ark of the Covenant was buried the same spot where Moses is at. So he's like, and it was angels that buried the body of Moses. That's why he's asking the angel where the body of Moses is at. They said, where exactly did y'all bury? I know it's Mount Nebo, but where exactly did you bury him? Because I figure if I find his body, then I'll find the Ark of the Covenant. Why? Because the Ark of the Covenant represents the throne. It represents the seat of authority. See how slick he is? He's talking about, what's up, Mike? Where's y'all bury Moses at? Like you really want to know. But we just read you the reason why. Because the Ark of the Covenant. That's why he wants that. See, that's the reason. See,
yeah.
That's why I encourage y'all to sit down and read these things. Dr. Kinley said it best. He says, you got a book. Try reading it sometime. Yeah. Talking about a Bible. This is what he's talking about, a Bible. Mm-hmm. See, you got a book. Try reading it sometime.
Yeah.
And you have to read it. Otherwise, how are you going to understand these charts? These charts are illustrations of what's in that book. But the thing about it is, you're going to go back into it with the knowledge of Elohim and the pattern and its purpose. See, that's what makes us different than everybody else, because we correct the versions of the Bible. Why? Because we say we have knowledge of a prophetic vision and revelation. Okay? All right? I think we're out of time. Thank you very much. For your time and your patience. And as always, we hope that you're edified by the things that we bring out. And take the time and look at these things. Look at the material. Our founder left a wealth of material. Go and read it. Peruse it. Read, research, rehearse. And it's by revelation that Yahweh is going to show you, okay? All right. Again, thank you very much for your time and your patience. Be safe, be healthy, but most of all, be in Yahshua the Messiah, who truly is your only hope of glory. And with those few words, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Okay, thank you for that. That concludes today's lectures. Workshop, are there any announcements? No announcements? Okay, we have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays 7:30 to 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser, Treasurer. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Yeah, I was going to say, what's his name, Frank Lewis?